blessings and grace bestowed on you from the God of wide welcome and lavish love. I am Susan Boyer, Senior Pastor of the Laverne Church of the Brethren, and it is my privilege to remind you that the Spirit of God is here among us. I welcome you into this community regardless of whether you are watching this service as it premieres or weeks after, whether this is your first time to participate in our worship or you come here often. As we continue in the spirit of worship, I want to encourage you to go and grab your mask and have it available. Our prayer time today is going to be a blessing of the masks that we wear for the safety of ourselves and for others. I have a couple things I want to tell you. First of all, if you are a part of this church family or have subscribed to our monthly email list, you should be getting that this week. It has great information about upcoming virtual opportunities like Cooking with Corlin or Guess Who's Coming to Zoom. We'll be having an all-church council meeting via Zoom webinar in October, and there you will learn more about the state of your church. The youth are planning a virtual night called Painting with Eric Davis. This is a fundraiser so that they can provide Christmas gifts for a family in need this year. We have some good stuff planned, as you can hear, so look for that email. We want you to participate. If you don't get that email and would like to, a way that you get onto that is to email the church office at office@lavernecob.org and ask to be added. Next Sunday is World Communion Sunday, and we have a fabulous group of people participating in worship. So join us in our virtual worship with a glass of water or juice or beverage of choice and a cracker or piece of bread, or if you want, you can even bake up some of our traditional communion bread. The recipe for that is in our monthly email. I want you to take a moment now to ponder what a blessing is. What does it mean to be blessed? Jan Richardson says that a blessing is like a thin place that helps us perceive how earth is infused with heaven. Barbara Brown Taylor writes, "Earth is so thick with divine possibility that it's a wonder we can walk anywhere without cracking our shins on altars." As we worship together today, may you be blessed. May you crack your shins on some altars that others have built to memorialize the presence of God right here in our world.
Interposed his precious blood. kids. This is my dog, Foster. I think you've met him here before. He's been a part of our family for a long time. He's getting pretty old now. He doesn't hear or see that well anymore, but you sure wouldn't know that by how excited he gets every time we come home from being away. And that was just my husband going out to get the mail. Foster would stay by our side all day long if it were up to him. We're the ones that leave. But you know what? He never holds a grudge. He's always there when we get home, wagging his tail, jumping up and down with joy, telling us he missed us and how happy he is to see us again. Sometimes when one of us have had a bad day, maybe because we messed up or we're angry or sad about something, Foster just knows that it's time to snuggle up close, and he looks up at us with these sweet dark eyes as if to say, "It's gonna be all right. I'm here, I love you, we'll get through this together." You know what? I think we can learn about the nature of God through these relationships we share with our furry friends. It's a blessing to believe that no matter how far we stray, how much we mess up, or how bad we feel, God is always there, waiting for us, forgiving us, loving us unconditionally, and saying, "I'm here, I love you, we'll get through this together." Will you pray with me? Dear God, thank you for always being here for us and loving us no matter what. Amen.
Hi, my name's Jonah Evans. I'll be reading from the book of Genesis, chapter 27, verses 30 to 38. And then right after Isaac had blessed Jacob and Jacob had left, Esau showed up from the hunt. He also had prepared a hearty meal. He came to his father and said, "Let my father get up and eat of his son's game, that he may give me his personal blessing." His father Isaac said, "And who are you?" "I am your son, your firstborn, Esau." Isaac started to tremble, shaking violently. He said, "Then who hunted game and brought it to me? I finished the meal just now before you walked in, and I blessed him. He's blessed for good." Esau, hearing his father's words, sobbed violently and most bitterly and cried to his father, "My father, can't you also bless me? Your brother," he said, "came here falsely and took your blessing." Esau said, "Not for nothing was he named Jacob, the heel. Twice now he's tricked me. First he took my birthright, and now he's taken my blessing." He begged, "Haven't you kept back any blessing for me?" Isaac answered Esau, "I've made him your master, and his brothers his servants, and lavished grain and wine on him. I've given it all away. What's left for you, my son? But don't you have just one blessing for me, father?" "Oh, bless me, father, bless me," Esau sobbed inconsolably.
I give to the Laverne Church of the Brethren because I love the space created by our faith community. I love the beauty of the physical space we maintain, and I want to see it shared with the larger community. I love the garden and the kitchen and the things that happen in those spaces. I love the art and artists. I love the children and the teachers. And I especially love the weekly spoken word essay. All these make up our faith community. So I do what I can to support the church, to pay salaries, to maintain buildings. I remind myself that dollars and cents don't measure the true value of things, and that Jesus treasured the widow's mite. What I get back for what I give is a sense of belonging to you.
Great God of mercy, bless these masks. Not the ones we wear sometimes to hide our true selves, but the ones we wear for the safety of others. You desire that all people should have life and have it abundantly. You call us to care for one another, putting the needs of our neighbor on a par with our own. So bless these face masks, which we wear during this time of pandemic. May they protect us and all those we encounter from the threat of COVID-19. May those who wear them never bring harm upon anyone, knowingly or unknowingly, by spreading this terrible disease. Holy Spirit, grant us a peaceful heart. Teach us patience. Save us from mask fatigue. Help us turn to you in prayer when we are irritable or afraid, or when the journey seems too long for us. As our Buddhist friends say, to know the problem is to find a way to end the suffering. May these masks extend our efforts to guard and protect one another in charity, becoming a shining witness to the love of Jesus Christ and to God's peace forever and ever. Amen.
I will be reading from the book of Genesis, chapter 28, verses 10 through 19. Jacob left Beersheba and went toward Haran. He came to a certain place and stayed there for the night, because the sun had set. Taking one of the stones of the place, he put it under his head and lay down in that place. And he dreamed that there was a ladder set up on earth, the top of it reaching to heaven, and the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. And the Lord stood beside him and said, I am the Lord, the God of Abraham your father, and the God of Isaac. The land on which you lie I will give to you and your offspring. And your offspring shall be like the dust of the earth, and you shall spread abroad to the west, and to the east, and to the north, and to the south. And all the families of the earth shall be blessed in you and your offspring. Know that I am with you, and will keep you wherever you go, and will bring you back to this land. For I will not leave you until I have done what I have promised you. Then Jacob woke from his sleep and said, Surely the Lord is in this place, and I did not know it. And he was afraid and said, How awesome is this place! This is none other than the house of God, and this is the gate of heaven. So Jacob rose early in the morning, and he took the stone that he had put under his head, and set it up for a pillar, and poured oil on the top of it. He called that place Bethel.
couple years ago, my son Matt invested in the Bibliotheca Bible. It's the Bible, separated into five books, but without chapters, verses, footnotes, or subject headings. The idea is that you get to read the Bible like you would most any other book. The Bibliotheca Bible advertises itself as a pure literary experience of the Bible's vast and varied contents. I was overjoyed to hear my son was reading the Bible, and I also wanted to hear if the Bible in this format changed the experience for him. Matt told me that he felt freer reading the Bible this way. He didn't feel pushed in any specific direction, and because it was more like reading other books, he was more inclined to keep reading it through. He said the way our Bibles are constructed makes the whole process of reading them feel geometric, like we're reading a proof. He said reading the Bible without footnotes, chapters, verses, or subject headings allowed the gift of poetry to come through. The way most of us read the Bible is so disjointed. We pull out a story here or a quote from Paul there without paying attention to its literary context. I thought of that as I was preparing for this worship service. One of the things that consistently amazes me is that I see new things in the Bible all the time, depending on what's happening in my own life or what's on the news that day or how I read the Bible. Today we heard two different scriptures that tell parts of the life of Jacob. A lot of us know these stories of Jacob's life, but we usually hear them pulled apart from each other for the convenience of a Sunday morning worship service time frame. We don't hear them in their literary context. The first scripture that was read needs some context, just in case you aren't familiar with the story or you need a refresher. Jacob and Esau were twins, born to Rebekah and Isaac after years of infertility. Esau was the oldest child, and his brother Jacob, whose name means supplanter, was born hanging onto the heel of his older brother. The story of their birth gives us a clue into the future relationship of these twin brothers. They were vastly different from each other. Esau grew up to be a man's man, always out hunting. Jacob stayed home, baked cookies, totally enmeshed with his mother. Rebekah was a mother who had a favorite child, and she wanted for her youngest child all the things that an oldest son was afforded in her culture. So mother and youngest son connived to steal Esau's birthright and blessing. First, Jacob gets Esau to sell him his birthright for a bowl of stew, but the theft of the blessing required more trickery. When Isaac is old and blind and bedridden, he decides he better get busy and bestow the blessing on Esau while he's still able to do so. He calls Esau to him, tells him to go hunting, come back with his game, and make his father a savory stew. Isaac says, "When you have the stew, come in to me and I will give you my blessing." Rebekah overhears this conversation, and as soon as Esau's out the back door, she grabs Jacob and whispers, "Come on, let's go. Let's get a move on." Rebekah dresses up Jacob in Esau's clothes and puts the skin of goats on his arms and the smooth part of his neck so that when Isaac touches him, he will think Jacob is actually his hairier brother. Then Rebekah sends Jacob into his father with a delicious stew in his hands. Jacob, a wolf in goat's clothing, goes into his father's bedroom and steals his brother's blessing right out from under the blind eyes of his aged father. First scripture that Jonah read today is Esau's reaction when he discovers that his mother and his twin brother were in cahoots to take what was his. He's devastated beyond words. He begs his father to bless him also, but his father claims he gave all his blessing away with his words to Jacob. Esau's words ring in our ears. "Don't you have just one blessing for me, Father? Oh, bless me, my father, bless me," Esau sobbed inconsolably. The second scripture Jonah read to us today picks up after Jacob runs for his life because his furious brother is planning to murder him. Jacob's parents, afraid of what's about to happen to their youngest son, tell him to run for his life. They suggest that he go to his kinsman Laban's house. And while you're there, can't you find a good Canaanite woman to marry, they suggest. Parents can't seem to help themselves. Jacob takes off in a run and doesn't stop until after the sun sets. When he can't go another step, he falls down onto the ground and pulls up a rock for a pillow. And in his exhaustion, he goes immediately to sleep and dreams of a stairway to heaven. In his dreams, angels are climbing up and down between the spot where he's sleeping and the very gate of heaven. And if that weren't amazing enough, he dreams that God comes and stands right beside him. God doesn't chastise Jacob. God doesn't tell him to return to his home and apologize to his brother. No. God promises that Jacob will have so many offspring, they'll be like the dust of the earth. God says he'll bless all the families of the earth through Jacob. God even adds a PS, I'm with you and I won't leave you. All my life, I've been so conflicted by this story. As a youngest child, there is part of me that has always secretly liked that God seems to choose Jacob over the oldest designated for blessing child. But at my core, I'm a rule follower who believes in the goodness of family, and I'm aghast at how Jacob and his mother, two con artists cut out of the same cloth, treated their very own family. And it doesn't help that when Jacob meets his uncle Laban, he found another family member who had no trouble cheating his own kin. What a family. But all these years of a geometrical reading of the Bible has taken its toll, and I have finally come to the conclusion that I missed something very important. I've read this story all my life as the story of Jacob, but by doing that, I missed the main character, God. I didn't see this story within its larger literary context. Jacob, a wretch, a self-indulgent child, a prodigal on the run, dreams of a stairway that leads to heaven's gates. But before Jacob can even climb those stairs, God comes to him. God doesn't give Jacob what he deserves, a lecture and a time out to think about his sins. God blesses him, promises to bless his children and his children's children and his children's children's children and all the families of the earth through Jacob, a dirty, rotten scoundrel. God is so unlike Jacob's father, Isaac, who declared he only had one limited blessing to bestow. God's blessings appear to be infinite, like the dust of the earth. It looks like God just throws around blessings recklessly in every direction. When Jacob wakes up from this incredible dream, he's still Jacob. He's still conniving and making deals. He declares, if you are true to your promise and stay with me, protect me, keep me in food and clothing, and return me safely to my father's house in one piece, then you can be my God. Jacob thinks he can make a deal even with God. Jacob treats this like he's buying a car. Throw in the undercoating and I'm in. Jacob makes the same mistake I did. He thinks this is his story, but it's larger than Jacob. This is a story about God's love and God's grace, things you can't earn, only receive. God doesn't love us because of who we are, because of who God is. What better way to make that clear than to bestow blessing and grace on this narcissistic deceiver, and then all of us through him? I feel like we just need to keep hearing this truth. There aren't limited blessings we have to win by deceit or birth order or our own purity or goodness. God is lavish with grace and extravagant with love. As Frederick Buechner says in his book, Wishful Thinking, grace is something you can never get but only be given. There's no way to earn it or deserve it or bring it about any more than you can deserve the taste of raspberries and cream, or earn good looks, or bring about your own birth. The crucial eccentricity of the Christian faith is the assertion that people are saved by grace. There's nothing you have to do. There's nothing you have to do. There's nothing you have to do. Just breathe that in for a second. Nothing, absolutely nothing, can separate you from the love of God through Christ Jesus. Nothing. Now, while that's the best news ever, it's also scandalous. That lavish grace that God offers to you is also bestowed on that scoundrel down the street that makes you crazy. And if that isn't enough, God loves the people you think are misled, even the ones you know are downright evil. Nadia Bowles Weber, in her latest book, Shameless, writes, "My Christian faith tells me that good news is only good if it is for everyone. Otherwise, it's just ideology." She says that makes the gospel the worst good news she's ever heard in her life. Friends, God loves Jacob as much as God loves Esau. This truth about God is outrageous, and the Bible is filled to overflowing with this message. Try reading the Bible stories all the way through with this truth in mind, and you'll see it everywhere. God loves the man in the ditch and the Levite that crossed on the other side of the road to avoid getting involved. God loved Jonah and the Ninevites. God loved the workers in the vineyard who worked all day and the ones who worked only 1 hour. From the prodigal son to his older brother. It seems nonsensical to say, but there's enough love and grace to go around. The God of Jacob and Esau loves us and lavishes us with blessings. There is enough blessing for every one of us prodigals. Amen. God comes to you with prodigal grace and extravagant love. God comes to all the families of the earth with prodigal grace and extravagant love. Blessings given freely. Go in peace. Amen.
Love that is liberty. Open our eyes and